Listen to what's happening around the world at TWR Today.
We listen to your Through the Bible program almost every day. It is our daily bread. We have heard a lot of biblical teaching and have been part of the church for many years. But if there is no life application, the teaching cannot satisfy. That is why we are thankful for your programs. You bring the Word of God close to our hearts.
TWR is bringing hope and encouragement to men and women all over the world.
Speaking hope to the world. This is TWR Radio 155.
It's 6:30. My name is Adam Rosanas, and it's my pleasure to join you at this time. Thank you to Rachel Badibanga for keeping company in the overnight and early morning hours. Now it's my pleasure to join you and keep you company all the way up until 1300, the program 100% Worship. Well, it's waste no time. Roger Zacharias awaits us now with his program, Let My People Think. This is part two of his message series, Jesus as They Saw Him.
In the eyes of the secular humanist today, Bertrand Russell is alive, that woman is dead. I want to tell you, if you understand what I'm driving at right now, in the eyes of Jesus, that woman is alive and Russell is dead.
Jesus Christ challenged the world with radical ideas. Ideas that seemingly contradicted everything mankind thought to be true. Hello and welcome to Let My People Think with author and apologist Ravi Zacharias. This week, Ravi Zacharias brings us part two of a message on the life of Jesus. In this series, Ravi is taking a look at why Jesus was so remarkably different, even in his culture. In fact, he was as controversial then as he is now. As we start today's broadcast, Ravi talks about the power of Jesus' words. And in our modern-day mindset where the image is exalted above the word, it's the teachings of Jesus that show the difference between something that catches the eye and something that grabs hold of the heart. Here's Ravi.
A good word is better than 1,000 pictures. I'll demonstrate that for you. It won't take me more than a minute. The credit is given to Alexander Pope. Talking about the conversion of water into wine, I want to tell you, this is a masterpiece. Listen, he says, the conscious water saw its master and blushed. Isn't that beautiful? The conscious water saw its master and blushed. Words, passion, reality. Do you realize that some of you are going to enter into the kingdom of God because one night this week you were here and heard a couple of fellows talking and singing something? How is it? It's because words are reflective of reality. And when the right words are used, reality is clutched at and it changes the entire dimensions of your life. Jesus, in his preaching, used powerful words. He described the Pharisee. He said, you strain at a gnat and you swallow a camel. He said, you garnish the sepulchres of the prophets after you have stoned them. He said, you scour the whole earth to look for one convert and then make him twicefold damnable for hell. His words were powerful. But do you know what he did in his preaching? He did two things. Jesus, as a preacher, in his preaching, forced people to see themselves as God sees them. My dear friend, I'm asking you tonight, have you seen yourself as God sees you? You look out into the world today and think of all of the freedom we are pining after, all of the things we are craving after. We think of technology. Technology has freed us. I can turn a dial and enter into experiences foreign to myself. Industry has freed us. I can pick up my bags, move from one city to another, find another job. Education has freed my mind and in some cases my consciences. Medicine has freed me from disease and in other instances freed other people from life. Chemistry has changed us and in some ways it has even affected our emotions. Psychiatry has set us free. You go on and on and on. And yet one writer describes us as homo perturbatus, restless man, intoxicated with a sense of freedom he has never had before. Restless man intoxicated with a sense of freedom he has never had before. Jesus shows you as you really are. And what Jesus says is this: when a man lives for himself, no matter how powerful the nations are, when a man lives to indulge and exploit and abuse his freedom, when a man thinks he has nothing good to do except live for himself, Jesus exposes that man as a liar, as a cruel, self-centered individual, and he describes you and me as those who are lost in the shackles of sin unless he himself comes to rescue us. Jesus in his preaching reveals to you who you really are, but much more than that, Jesus reveals to you who you ought to be. Jesus reveals to you who you ought to be. This is such a difficult concept and the heart of what I want to say to you tonight, that if you do not follow what I'm saying, I think you will miss what I think is the most important aspect of this message. In my office, there is a parchment, and I was speaking at a college someplace, I made this quote, and I made the comment that if somebody knew how to do calligraphy somewhere, it would be a great honor for me to hang that quote on in my office walls. And a young lady came forward afterwards and said she'd be delighted to do it. And where I sit behind my desk now, I can see that it is beautifully penned. In the last year, nothing, no one quote. And I read an awful lot of them, memorize an awful lot of them. I'm talking about those outside of the word now. No quote has wrestled in my mind more than this particular one. So many times I've said to my wife, I said, you know, honey, one of these days that quote is going to burst forth into some truths that I have never dreamed of before. I feel I'm touching the tip of an iceberg if only I can get to the core of what it is I'm trying to say. Please listen to me. Jesus Christ says that quote continually contradicts us in the way we experience ourselves as alive. And he compels us to radically redefine what we mean by life. He encounters us the way he encountered the disciples on Easter Sunday. They were the ones marked out for death. Those who had survived him were really the dead. He, the dead one, was really the living. Let me explain that to you. I was preaching in a tiny little village, in a country and in a village, better unnamed so you don't misunderstand me. They were all illiterate people sitting in front of me with smelly, dirty, unwashed clothes. There was one woman in there without one tooth inside her mouth. Her face looked so marred and scarred, and she was an elderly woman. I don't think there was a fraction of a portion of skin on her face that was unwrinkled. She'd squat there in front listening to the message every day, the simplest truths of the gospel, going through an interpreter. And one evening she came and said to the interpreter, I want to take this Jesus into my life. And then I'd see her smiling from ear to ear, night after night through the meetings. On the last day she came to the missionary, to the interpreter and myself. She was carrying a dirty bundle of clothes on her head. And I want to tell you, all her worldly belongings were in that tiny little dirty smelly bundle. If you got within 2 or 3 feet of her, you could get the aroma of an unwashed body and unwashed clothing. Earrings heavy, bringing the earlobes down almost to her ears. And she came over, clutched the hand of the fellow who'd been doing the interpreting for me and says, would you please ask these two men if somebody can take a picture of me with both of them? I would greatly appreciate it. The greatest day in her life was when she found Jesus. And she said, the second greatest thing is, I want a picture with these two gentlemen. I have that picture at home now, brethren. That dear woman standing next to me, if it had been permitted culturally, I would have done it. I wanted desperately to reach out and put my arm around her to see that fragile bag of bones standing there, going back to a shack that probably would be washed out by the first rainfall that monsoon time. And as she stood in the middle there and that picture was taken and I brought it home and that smile all across her face, I want to tell you this. If I took that picture to an average humanist, an atheist, a secularist, a pragmatist, whatever, he would look at the face of that woman, look at the personality of the woman, and say that woman is basically dead. And then I show him the picture of Russell with all of his degrees, all of his brilliance, all of his mathematizing and philosophizing, using his brilliance to knock out the foundations of belief in God from every other person he talked to, and yet a man who lived a promiscuous lifestyle so that even when he received his knighthood, the king said the quality of his life betrayed him an awful lot. And yet when I read his books and read his degrees and read his professorial status, and one of the most brilliant men that's ever lived, in the eyes of the secular humanist today, Russell is alive. That woman is dead. And I want to tell you, if you understand what I'm driving at right now, in the eyes of Jesus, that woman is alive and Russell is dead. Jesus Christ continually contradicts you in the way you experience yourself as alive, and he compels you to radically redefine what you mean by life. He encountered you the way he encountered the disciples on Easter Sunday. They were the ones marked out for death. Those who had survived him were really the dead. He, the dead one, was really the living. That's why the Pascals, that's why the Augustines, that's why the Edwards, that's why all of the great thinkers, men like Luther, Calvin, Zwingli, Polycarp, Ignatius, Origen, you go back through history, some of the greatest minds that ever lived bent their knee to him, and somehow he reverses all of our values. And I am saying to you tonight, this Jesus for 2,000 years has been the butt of ridicule of thousands of writers. They have not been able to dislodge him. The Bible is still the best-selling book in all the world. That Jesus can change your life. Thirdly, and very quickly, number one, the essential nature of his person. Number two, the definitive nature of his ministry. Number three, the efficacious nature of his provision. How does he do this? Number one, he ministers to me in my suffering. He ministers to me in my suffering. Maybe I told you this, I don't know. I took Sarah, our little girl, in for surgery, and the doctor was doing something in her ear because she'd had constant ear infections. And after the surgery was over, the doctor said, we have dealt with that problem, but he says, I've got some bad news for you. She's got a perforated eardrum, and the infection has spread, and I'm fearful that it has spread into the mastoid. I said, what does that mean, Doc? He said, there's really no point even discussing it until I get the x-rays. I said, but if the x-rays show that it has spread to the mastoid, what does it mean? He said, why don't you wait till we get the x-rays? That night I phoned my brother. He refused to tell me what it meant, and finally I pleaded with him. He says, well, the reason he is hesitant is because it's a very rare incident. But listen, he says, if it does happen, which is very, very rare, it really means that it threatens the very muscles on that side of the face, and they will not be able to tell you whether those muscles will hold together until after the surgery. That night, little Sarah was sound asleep, completely not knowing what lay ahead for her, possibly. And I remember downstairs, after getting off the phone with my brother, within 5 minutes, the doctor phoned me from NIAC there to tell me the x-rays had come back and the infection had spread. And it was only a long, long miracle of grace as we brought her back to Toronto to take her to one of the top surgeons in Toronto. And marvelously, by the grace of God, the situation has rectified itself. I remember that night when I walked upstairs, Margie, in our little son's room, Nathan's room, was rocking him to sleep. And when I walked in and turned one of the night lamps on and looked at Nathan in her arms, sound asleep, and my wife having the tears running down her face. Ladies and gentlemen, you don't have to live long to know sooner or later you're going to contact suffering. Jeremiah Denton, who wrote the book of the Revolution, one of the most marvelous books I've ever read of the grandness of some of the American boys in Vietnam. We often hear how miserably some of them fared. We seldom hear how powerful some of these were. Jeremiah Denton was the highest ranking American officer captured by the North Vietnamese, and he struggled and struggled and struggled for the honor of his land. As a matter of fact, at one stretch for many, many days, they didn't feed him till the insides within him were gnawing with pain because they were trying to persecute to get some information about him. And threw him, and he wouldn't give it. And then they finally told him they were going to serve him some food, and they brought a plate full of human feces for him to eat. Do you know what Denton says in that book when hell was in session? If it weren't for God, if it weren't for the love of Christ, and he says this, every boy I related to who was able to conquer this persecution had one thing in common, their faith in God. And then he wrote this poem about Mary, talking about Mary looking at Jesus on the cross. Her face showed grief, but not despair. Her head, though bowed, had faith to spare. And even now she could suppose her thorns would somehow yield a rose. Her life with him was full of signs that God writes straight with crooked lines. Dark clouds can hide the rising sun, and all seem lost when all be won. Are you hurting tonight? I want you to look at the cross for a moment When they tell you what crucifixion really was, it tells you that a Roman fellow called the lictor was trained in the art of persecution, muscles bound there with a huge whip, would come within approximate distance of the person to be scourged, and Jesus was scourged. They take the body, the clothes of the body of the individual to be scourged, his body scourged, his body was bent, tied into a stump of wood jutting out of the ground, wrists and ankles tied to that stump, and then the Roman lictor would pour that whip onto his body and peel out flesh and blood with every whipping. Matthew says, by the time they'd finished scourging him and took him to the cross, he hardly had enough strength left. And he says this, they all sat there and watched him. And Jesus says in his word that for this very cause he came into the world, so that he could die for your sins and mine. Are you going to make a mockery of that and say, I don't believe it? Or by faith and the reason of the resurrection, are you going to respond and say, all right, preacher, that Jesus has spoken to me tonight? His ministry to you through suffering. And I want to tell you some of the struggles I've been through, some of the physical disabilities I've picked up owing to the heavy onslaught of travel and the pressure within your body, and some of the loneliest moments I've been through. I can still stand before you tonight and say, if you gave me all the options in the world to be anything else, I wouldn't want it, because I know that deep within me lives this Christ. And I am completely at peace with gratitude with him within me. Which is my final thought. His ministry to you through suffering. His ministry in you through indwelling. His ministry in you through indwelling. You can ask me tonight, Ravi, are you pure? And I say, no, sir. But somebody in me is. Ravi, are you compassionate? In many ways, no. But somebody in me is. Can you preach with power? No, but there's somebody in me who can. In other words, this Jesus comes within you and doesn't only change what you do, he changes what you want. In closing, I would like to read this for you. It's a sermon written by a fellow who entitled What Pilate Said to Gaius One Night. It's marvelous. I'm just going to take excerpts of this. And after I read this, I'm going to pray with you and then give you an opportunity to respond. So please listen as I read this to you. What Pilate said to Gaius one night, some years after the crucifixion, a writer using his imagination. It suddenly closed in on me, Gaius, the impact of how trapped I was. The proud arm of Rome with all its boast of justice was to be but a dirty dagger in the pudgy hands of the priests. I was waiting in the room, Gaius, I used for court, officially enthroned with cloak and guard when they let this Jesus in. Well, Gaius, don't smile at this as you value your jaw, but I've had no peace since the day he walked into my judgment hall. It's been years, Gaius, but those scenes I'll read from the back of my eyelids every night. You've seen Caesar, haven't you, when he was young, inspecting the legion. His arrogant manner was childlike compared to the manner of the Nazarene. He didn't have to strut, you see. He walked towards my throne, arms bound with a strident mastery, this Jesus did, and a kind of a control that by its very audacity silenced the room for an instant and left me trembling with an insane desire to stand up and salute. The clerk began reading the absurd list of charges, the priestly delegations punctuating these with the palm rubbings, the beard strokings, the eye rollings, and the pious gutturals, by now which I had learned to ignore. But I more felt it, Gaius, than heard it. I questioned him mechanically, and he answered very little. But what he said and the way he said it, it was as if his level gaze had pulled up my naked soul right up into my eyes and was probing it there. And the voice kept singing in my ears, why, you're on trial, Pilate, and that the man wasn't even listening to the charges. You'd have sworn he had just come in out of friendly interest to see what was going to happen to me. And the very pressure of his standing there had grown unbearable when a slave rushed in all a tremble, interrupting court, bringing a message from Claudia. She had stabbed at the stylus in that childish way that she does when she's distraught. Don't judge this amazing man, Pilate, she wrote. I was haunted in dreams by him this night. Gaius, I tried to free him. From that moment on, I tried, and I always think he knew it. I declared him out of my jurisdiction, being a Galilean, but the native King Herod discovered he was born in Judea and sent him right back to me. I appealed to the crowd, hoping that they would be his sympathizers, but Caiaphas had stationed agitators to whip up the beasts that cry for blood, and you know how in this town here, any citizen loves the blood of another person just after breakfast and screams for another's blood. I had him beaten, Gaius, a thorough barracks room home beating. I'm still not sure why. To appease the crowd, I guess. But do we Romans really need any reason for beatings? Isn't that the code for anything we don't understand? Well, it didn't work, Gaius. The crowd roared like some slavering beast when I brought him back. If only you could have watched him. They had thrown some rags of mock purple over his pulped and bleeding shoulders. They had jammed a chaplet of thorns down on his forehead, and it fitted. It all fitted, Gaius. He stood there, watching them from my balcony. Flame from weakness by now, but royal, I tell you. Not just pain, but pity shining from his eyes. And I kept thinking, somehow this is monstrous. This is upside down. That purple is real. That crown is real. And somehow these animal noises the crowd is shrieking should be praise. And then Caiaphas played his masterstroke on me. He announced there in public that this Jesus claimed the crown, and that was treason to Caesar. And the guards began to glance at one another quickly, and that mob of spineless filth began to shout, "Hail Caesar! Hail Caesar!" And Gaius, I knew I was beaten. I gave the order. I couldn't look at him. Then I did a childish thing. I called for water. And there on the balcony, I washed my hands of that whole affair. But as they led him away, Gaius, I did look up, and he turned and looked at me. No smile, no pity, just glanced at my hands. And I'll feel the weight of his eyes on them from now on. But you're yawning, Gaius. I've kept you up. And the fact of the matter is, you're in need of some rest and some holidays. Claudia will be asleep by now. Rows of lighted lamps line her couch. She can't sleep in the dark anymore. No, not since that afternoon. You see, Gaius, the sun went out when my guards executed him. That's exactly what I said. I don't know how. I don't know what. I only know that I was there. And though it was the middle of the day, it turned as black as the tunnels of hell in that miserable city. And while I tried to compose Claudia and explain how I'd been trapped, she railed at me with a dream, and she's had that dream ever since. When she sleeps in the dark, some form of it, that there was to have been a new Caesar, and that I, her husband, had killed him. Oh, we've been to Egypt, to their seers and magicians. We've listened by the hour to the oracles in the musty temples of Greece chattering their inanities. We've called it an oriental curse that we're under, and we've tried to break it a thousand ways, Gaius, but there's no breaking it, except, and even that, it might not, you see. But you know why I've kept going, Gaius? Deeper than the curse is the haunting, driving certainty that he is still somewhere near, and that I have some unfinished business with him, and that now and then as I walk by the lake, he's following me. And much as that strikes terror, Gaius, I wonder if that isn't the only hope. You see, if I could walk up to him, and this time salute, and tell him that now I know that whoever else he is, he was the only man worthy of his name in all Judea that day. Tell him I know I wasn't trapped, that I trapped myself. Tell him here is one Roman who wishes he really were Caesar. I believe that would do it, Gaius, wouldn't it? I believe he'd listen and lament it. And at last I'd see him smile. Yes, quiet tonight. Not a breeze stirring, Gaius. Good night, you'd better run along. No. Would you please waken the slave outside the door and tell him to bring me my cloak, my heavy one, please? I believe I'll walk by the lake. Yes, it's dark there, Gaius, but I won't be alone. I really haven't ever been alone, not since that day. Yes, good night, Gaius. The conscious water saw its master and blushed. Ladies and gentlemen, you can hear all the sermons you want to hear. You can read all the books you want to read. You will never find out what we are talking about until you experience Jesus.
That concludes this week's message from apologist Ravi Zacharias. Join us again next week as we hear more from apologist Ravi Zacharias. Let My People Think is a listener-supported radio ministry that is furnished by Ravi Zacharias International Ministries, Atlanta, Georgia.
You're listening to TWR Radio 155.
When I survey
just heard music by Catherine Scott, and we have time for one more song before our next program at 7 o'clock. This is the group Celtic Cry.
Radio 155.
It's 7 o'clock. Let's join Pastor Asafa Makanga for his program, Living Word for Africa.
Welcome to the Living Word for Africa, brought to you by Trans World Radio, on air Monday through Friday, teaching the Word of God, based on Dr. McGee's Through the Radio Bible Program. Before we get into the actual study, let's listen to this song.